Father, help your children and don't let them fall by the side of the road, and teach them to love one another, that heaven might find a place in their hearts. 'Cause Jesus is love. He won't let you down. And I know
morning. Welcome to Historic Pleasant Green Missionary Baptist Church. We're located at 540 West Maxwell Street in the city of Lexington, Kentucky. My name is Reverend Mark A. Dunn, Associate Minister, speaking. We will have our call to worship this morning from John 4:24. It reads, God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. God is a spirit, and they that worship must worship him in spirit and in truth. We will now be led in our worship of music by Brother Marion Shockley.
More than anything. far enough. Tell me, what do you say when your friends turn away and you're all alone, all alone? Tell me, what do you give when you give it your all and it seems like you can't make it through? Well, you just stay. When there's nothing left to do, you just stay and watch the Lord see you through after you've done all you can. You just stay.
John, the 11th chapter, the 33rd verse. John 11, beginning at the 33rd verse. Therefore, when Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her weeping, he groaned in the spirit and was troubled. And he said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus wept. Then the Jews said, "See how he loved him?" And some of them said, "Could not this man, who opened the eyes of the blind, also have kept this man from dying?" May the Lord bless the readers and hearers and doers of his holy and divine word. Please join me now for a word of prayer. Most holy and all-wise God, we come now, God, at this time, this preaching hour, to give you thanks and to give you praise for all that you have done and all that you continue to do in our lives. We thank you, Father, for this opportunity to reach your people. We ask, God, that you will bless this servant with your preaching power. Allow the folks to listen and hear your word. Thank you, God, for all that are under the sound of my voice, and thank you for keeping us safe through this pandemic. We ask, God, you continue to bless us and keep us. In Jesus' name, amen. So there is a word from the Lord, but before we get to that, let me just discuss just a little bit about kind of the climate that is going on right now in our nation. As I prepared for this sermon, I was looking ahead at the calendar and I saw that today is Father's Day. So happy Father's Day to all the fathers that would be listening. Then I noticed that we would be doing this filming on Friday, June 19th. Juneteenth in our culture. So happy June 19th to all those who celebrate June 19th, Juneteenth. And then I thought about this time last year, particularly our former pastor always loved Father's Day because it fell real close to his birthday. And I believe his birthday was on Wednesday, the 17th of this month. He would have been 81 years old. We thank God for his ministry, for his legacy, and what he has meant to this grand old place. May he continually rest in peace. And then there are the protests. Protest against the police brutality and the senseless killings. There are all of those things. A lot going on in our world, in our nation, and a lot of suffering. And so that brought me to the title of our sermon this day. Christ sees our suffering. Christ sees our suffering. John's gospel is all business. It is a firm declaration of the identity of Jesus. It serves to establish Jesus as the anointed one, the Messiah, the incarnate Son of God. John, the beloved disciple, member of the inner circle of disciples with his brother, James and Peter, highlights seven ministry events or marks of the Messiah, to demonstrate that Jesus is the Son of God. All of this would have invoked a cognitive reconciliation in the minds of those witnessing the events. They knew to expect someone. The prophets of old said so. They knew the signs or prophecies that would be evidence of the Anointed One. But this man is from Nazareth. They would need to come out of their headspace and receive him in their heart space. In the midst of this presentation of this body of evidence, we find this very moving account of Jesus' personal, human connection with his people. The passage is from a lengthy discourse provided in John's gospel about concerning the death of Jesus' friend Lazarus. However, my focus today isn't so much on the death and resurrection of Lazarus as it is the depth of emotion demonstrated by Jesus in the unpretentious invitation extended to him by the people who were mourning the death of his friend. The first point I'd like to kind of lift up today is Jesus showed his empathy. Now, empathy defined in the Merriam-Webster Dictionary is the action of undertaking or understanding, being aware of, being sensitive to, and vicariously experiencing the feelings, thoughts, and experience of another of either the past or present without having the feelings, thoughts, and experience fully communicated in an objectively explicit manner. Now that's a whole lot of words, there's a whole lot of stuff that they've thrown together in that dictionary, but if you ever watched the movie Avatar, there's a little connection in there where those folks make, where they say, I see you. And by saying I see you, what they're saying is that I'm connected with you. I am enmeshed with you. And I believe that is what this empathy that Jesus is trying to demonstrate is. And I think that's more of what Merriam-Webster kind of sums it up for you. Jesus has been aware of his friend's illness and poor prognosis long before Mary and Martha sent word to him. When he finally arrived in Bethany, Lazarus had been in the tomb for 4 days. The sisters met him separately along the way, each expressing the same sentiment. If you had been here, my brother would not have died. Notice here, Jesus never apologized for being tardy. How many of you know him as an on-time God? He never said, I'm sorry, or made any excuse for his absence. No verbal communication. See, he may not come when you want him, but he's always on time. Besides, can you really be late to an event when you see its end before it ever begins? Jesus knew the plan. Yet when he saw the tears of Mary and the other mourners, he groaned in the spirit and was troubled. Barnes notes advises that the word rendered here groaned commonly denotes to be angry or indignant, or to reprove severely, denoting violent agitation of the mind. The commentary further expounds this description by suggesting this violent agitation results from grief and not anger. Jesus saw and experienced the pain in their sorrow, and he was moved. Jesus showed his compassion. Jesus showed compassion many times, often when he saw a multitude of people. Matthew 9:36 says that as Jesus went about teaching, preaching, and healing in the various cities, he was moved with compassion at the sight of the multitude he viewed as sheep having no shepherd. He fed the 4,000 after they had traveled with him for 3 days. Isaiah tells us that the Messiah would be a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. By moving toward the tomb where Lazarus lay, Jesus showed his compassion for the people. The people were weeping, and Jesus wept. They suffered because of who is in the tomb. To alleviate their suffering, Lazarus needed to come out of the tomb. Jesus feels pity for the suffering of the people, particularly Martha and Mary. He knew all the while what his motive was for this, but they didn't. And this in no way diminishes the feeling of sympathy Jesus had for those around the tomb. He was on his way to the cross, and he knew that. And Jesus moved by the invitation. There are often obstacles in the way of our relationship with God or his work within us. Chief among them is our failure to invite the Lord in. Notice here in verse 34 that Jesus inquired about the tomb. That was his concern, but waited for the people to invite him to come on and see. Immediately following the invitation, Jesus wept. He wept as a loving friend. He wept because it is natural to do so. He wept because he entered into their sympathy. He did not weep for the dead because he knew what he was about to do for the dead. So his sympathy wasn't for Lazarus being in the tomb. His sympathy was for the people mourning the loss. He wept because in all his humanness, he experienced the pain that his eventual departure would trigger in those whom the Father had given him. He was on his way to the cross. I love the way that Jerry Vernon McGee comments on this topic. He writes, "While John's gospel is written to show us the deity of Christ, here Jesus is shown in all his humanness. He even asked where Lazarus was laid because he was so human. And here we can see the way God feels at a funeral today. He mingles his tears with ours." Consider for a moment the current climate in America and perhaps the world. The multitude now mourn the senseless deaths of four individuals, Arbery, Taylor, Floyd, and Brooks, and countless others. Well-meaning protests are marred by unacceptable rioting and looting. The excruciating pain of injustice has produced a collective weeping and groaning in the multitude. And Jesus wept. Luke's gospel records how Jesus wept over Jerusalem as he drew near the city for his triumphal entry. The multitude rejoiced and sang praises, but Jesus wept, saying, "If you had known even you, especially in this day, the things that make for your peace, but now they are hidden from your eyes." The commentary for this verse and following reads, "He wept because of one, the great privileges that were being abused, two, the great possibilities that had been rejected, and three, the great punishment he knew was coming on the city and its people." Jerusalem had abandoned its faith. Jerusalem had rejected the Messiah. And Jerusalem would be laid to waste with terrible judgment. And Jesus wept. He wept because of the people turning their back. He wept because the people didn't understand and recognize who he was. He wept because he could see the future that they could not see. And it pained him. And in his humanness, he was sorrowful. And he wept. This was their day of opportunity. Jesus made himself available to them, but they nailed him to a cruel Roman cross. But it was on that old Roman cross that he shed his blood. Without the shedding of blood, there can be no remission of sin. It was on that old Roman cross that he paid in full the debt owed by the multitude. It was on that cross where Jesus asked the Father to forgive them, for they know not what they do. It was on that cross where Jesus declared, "It is finished." And the multitude wept and mourned because he died. But the story cannot end there. You see, they took his body and prepared it for burial in Joseph's new tomb. And the people mourned because of who was in the tomb. But early one Sunday morning, Jesus got up and declared all power in his hand. He saw the weeping and the mourning. He saw the pain in the people. And he got up. If he had stayed in the tomb, we wouldn't have our salvation. If he had stayed buried in that tomb, we would not have a relationship with God. He had to get up. He didn't decide to die. He came to die. He came to pay the debt for us. That's why he came. It wasn't a decision. It was a debt that he needed to pay. He died for us. But he didn't stay there. He did get up. He got up with all power in his hand. He got up and sits at the right hand of the Father. And I only wonder now how he looks at us. Does he see us as he saw Jerusalem on his triumphal entry? Does he look at America and see the evil, the pain, the struggle? Does he look at us and does he weep? And this is where we stand now, as a way of serving as an invitation to you. This is where we stand. And this is a commentary from Ray C. Steadman. "The secret of humanity is open to anyone who opens his or her own heart to the Son of Man, the perfect man. He alone has penetrated the depths of the human spirit. He alone reestablishes the lost relationship with God that enables us to be what God intended us to be. He alone saves us and restores what was lost in the fall of man, in the entrance of sin into the world. He alone can restore the marred, distorted image of God in our lives. That's what we have today, and that is what we're offering today. Jesus has already paid the price. Jesus has already been on the cross. Jesus has already been in the tomb. He's already risen. He is risen. That is what we pay today. That is what we offer today. If you don't know Jesus in the pardon of your sin, I invite you to come. When the doors of the church are open for people to come back in, we invite you to come. Until then, you can reach us at 859-254-7387. Christ sees our suffering. Now to him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forevermore.